Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Our dear Master and our dear Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who loved us and gave himself for us, we thank you because of your kindness and your mercy and your blessings and your desire to offer yourself to us and your desire to draw us close and your desire to draw us near, to be united with us, dear Lord, that you might change us from the inside. I ask, dear Lord, for your presence here, for your words to be spoken by your Spirit to our hearts. I pray, dear Lord, that you would effect the change in our lives that we need. We thank you for these holy times you've given us to remind us of what you've done for us and how you desire for us to always be with you. We ask the intercession of St. Mary and the witnesses of the Transfiguration and St. Veronica, hear us when we are children, cry unto you with one voice, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you guys again. There's a lot of old faces. That doesn't mean that you're old and that your faces look old, but some faces we haven't seen for a while, so it's nice to have you back with us. We are doing a series on the miracles of Jesus Christ. And why are we studying the miracles? There's lots of reasons. There's lots of people who didn't believe he did anything. And what's interesting is there's so much literature, not only inside the Bible, but outside of the Bible. People who believed that Jesus Christ, whether they were Jews, like some of the Jewish historians, or even the Romans, they always associated this Jesus Christ with wondrous deeds. We believe they are miracles attributed to him. They could not deny them. So Jesus Christ is associated with wondrous deeds. They could not deny it. For us, these indicate his divine nature, that he had power over nature. He had power over demons. He had power over illness. And he had power over death. We saw that he could create eyes. He could multiply bread. And he could change water into wine. For those of you who are chemists, you understand how complicated this is. If we believe that he really did these, and these are attributed to him, then we believe he is God, that all things are possible to him, and not only then, but also now. In our lives, in our age, he's the same God. The same God from back then is the same God that we believe now. I want to ask you, were there any miracles that Jesus couldn't perform? There were some that he wouldn't perform, but there was none that he couldn't perform. Why did he choose not to perform some in some areas in his hometown? Well, also, in his hometown, he said, because of your lack of faith, he wouldn't do them. There was nothing that he couldn't do, but there are some things that he wouldn't do. Now, I know that everyone here believes that he does miracles, because you came here today. You guys keep coming back. You come here every week. You've been doing it for years, because you believe that a miracle happens here every single time you come. In every Orthodox liturgy you've ever been to, you believe that that's not just bread and wine. That by a divine act, that the Jesus Christ who offered himself on the cross 2,000 years ago, his body and blood are present in this. This is a divine act. And you guys are seeing it every single time. Was there ever a time you guys attended a liturgy where it didn't happen? So it happened every single time? He always does that miracle. The thing is, you may not be in awe of that miracle anymore, as we should be. What else do these miracles tell us about God, besides the fact that he's all-powerful? They tell us about his compassion and his mercy and his deep concerns about the needs of our lives. He tries to fulfill our needs in his way and in his time. But it's because of his compassion and his care. Like, why raise the son of a widow after dying? I mean, he's dead. Why did he need to come back? Why did he do it? Because he had compassion on the widow, on the mom, because she was already lost her husband, and if she loses her son, she has no way for income. He didn't do it for himself. He didn't do his miracles for his glory, because oftentimes he told the people, don't tell anyone about what I did, or go tell the priest, but don't tell anyone. He wasn't doing it to show off. But because of his care and compassion, he tried to fulfill the needs of his people. The feeding of the 5,000. He says, now Jesus called his disciples to himself and he said this, I have compassion on the multitude. Because they've now continued with me 3 days and have nothing to eat, and I don't want to send them away hungry lest they faint on the way. Why did he do that miracle? Which was a very cool miracle. It was because he cared. He didn't want them to faint. Does that mean if you don't get the healing that you want, or the better job, or the traffic parting into two ways when you're coming every time you ask God, God, please help me to find the best parking spot, does that mean he doesn't care about you anymore? He has wisdom. We don't give our kids everything they ask for and everything they want, even though you have the ability to give them a lot of the things they ask for. Because after a while, you sense that they stop loving you, but they only care about the things. So you don't give them everything they want every time they ask because you know it's not good for them. It's very similar in our own lives. God has reasons for doing the miracles he does, and he does them for you every single day, and you don't realize it. But they're there. He hasn't stopped loving you or caring about you or taking care of your needs. He does it every single day, and for sure, every single week. He has a reason for doing the things he does, and he does so many miracles, so many, that one of the last verses in the Gospel of John, it says this, this is the disciple, John is saying, this is the disciple who testifies of these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true, and there are so many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Meaning we have a few of the miracles written in the Bible, but he did so many, John's like, they're nonstop. Miracles are happening, and he didn't stop doing miracles. He's still doing them in our lives. We want to study them because they reveal to us something about God's character. And hopefully, in seeing something about his character, we will have a greater desire to draw closer to him once you see how beautiful he is, especially during Lent. So today I wanted to focus on a miracle within the story of a miracle. It's a very unusual miracle, but yet I find it very beautiful. And I think every one of us is actually in the story. Every one of us. I promise you are in the story. No, it's not a demon possession miracle, so don't worry. It's like not that. Relax. But it's written in several places, and we're going to read from Mark 5, 21 through 34. Now when Jesus crossed over again by boat to the other side, he had just done miracles casting out demons, legion, the thousands of demons that went into the swine. So everyone's hearing about his miracles. A great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jairus by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet. And he begged him earnestly, saying, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed and she will live. So Jesus went with him. And a great multitude followed him and thronged him. I don't know if you guys use the word thronging very much, but you've seen it, Egyptian crowds. And we'll go over that in a second. This is where I want us to focus. Now a certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years. And had suffered many things from many physicians. She spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. That doesn't happen with doctors today. Like, you can trust them. They're much better today. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, if only I may touch his clothes, I shall be made well. Immediately the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her blood that she was healed of the affliction. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to him, "You see the multitude thronging you, and you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see her who had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell down before him and told him the whole truth, such as a confession. And he said to her, "Daughter," "your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction." So there's a crowd. They're elbowing and they're butting their way to be right next to Christ just to get a hand on him. The text implies they're crushing him. They are crushing him. And when Jesus asks, "Who touched me?" Everyone's like, who's pushing? It wasn't me. I didn't touch you. Like, I didn't do that. And then Peter says, "You know, it's kind of absurd what you're asking. I mean, can't you see that everybody here is touching you? Like, why are you asking that question? Are you just being facetious? Are you trying to say something funny?" Well, why did he ask? Was he upset that the people were clawing at him with great irreverence? He's been doing miracles all the time. This is not the first crowd that have been thronging him a lot, but we don't hear him asking that question every time he's in the crowd. This time he does. Because of all the touches of all the people in all the crowds, I would imagine thousands had touched him in a crowd. But he wanted to bring attention to a special touch of all the thousands. Lots of people touching, but only one received something. Before I talk about the one, I want to talk about the countless others. The possibly irreverent, aggressive touches of the crowds, touching the Son of God, and nothing happens to them that we're aware of. I'm sure some of them had been sick. I'm sure some of them were in desperate need. But we don't hear anything happen to them. Did Christ not care about them? Of course he did. So where are we in this whole story of this woman and the crowd? Are we the members of the crowd clawing at Jesus with no significant benefit? Or are we like the one who touched Christ and received? The sad thing is that many of us relate to the crowd. It's kind of like what happens, like, you know, when a pope comes, or a relic or an icon. It's like just a barakah touch. I just want a barakah. I just want something goodness in my life. I want my kids to have communion. So I know it's good for them. And so I just want to go and touch it. Let's just have communion. And so we just go. And usually there's a bunch of people. I'll tell you a story of, it was actually my friend's mom. He didn't announce that it was his mom, but I found out later. When Pope Shenouda went to the airport in Detroit, huge, huge crowd, but his mom was special. She decided to get on a bench, and when he came, jump over the crowd onto the Pope, because that was going to be real barakah, right? I didn't hear any miracles, but the security really were getting their pay. They were earning their pay on that day. But actually, this is very much what we do in our own spiritual lives. We have these irreverent, mindless, unintentional touches, just like the rest of the crowd. How many times do we just read the Bible quickly and hope for a barakah, but we don't really benefit? And many of us are reading the Bible not expecting to benefit. We're reading it because I know that I'm supposed to. So you read it and you put it down and say, okay, that was the word of who? The God who with his words could say, "Let there be light," and there was light, and the sun showed up. That God, his words, and we like, okay, yeah, I read it. Or sometimes we come to communion and the same thing. We get in the line because we know it's good for our kids. And it's a barakah. But you don't expect, and just like you've been doing it for years, nothing has happened to you when you've had communion. Or when you go to pray. Physically, you go before God. You maybe not spiritually, and you don't expect that when you speak in front of God, the Pantocrator, the one who sent his son to die on the cross for you, who is able to do above all that you ask or imagine, you go into the presence of that God and nothing happens. And you don't expect anything to happen. Is it God's fault? It's not. It's actually ours. It's not because of who he is. We go into the prayer because of what we want or what we think we deserve. We go through so many of these empty touches. We come near or close within the vicinity of Christ, but not like this woman with the hemorrhage. She had a special touch that connected her with Christ in a very unique and life-changing way. So Christ made great notice of this woman out of so many. Jesus wasn't asking who was elbowing him, but he recognized the difference between the crowd's touches and her touches. What was the difference? He felt power. This touch released the power of God. Did Jesus Christ touch her? Did he say a prayer over her? Did he say, you be healed? No. The power was released by her touch. She actually initiated the miracle. So she had a hemorrhage for 12 years. She had some type of menstrual disorder, and I'm not going to go into different kinds, but it sounds terrible. Physically, socially, religiously, and spiritually. There are all kinds of hemorrhagic disorders, and we're not going to talk about that, but when you have this kind of disorder, what happens to you? You become severely anemic. So severe anemia, you know, our hemoglobin usually is around like 12 to 14. I've had patients where their hemoglobin is like 5. You know, they're like barely alive. They are so weak. They're so fatigued that getting out of bed is a struggle. They're lightheaded. They're dizzy. They're short of breath because they're trying to get oxygen. Their heart is pumping so fast. Everything is a struggle for them. So that's what she had. She had this struggle just to move. Well, what about religiously? How did it affect her religiously? If you go back to your favorite book, Leviticus, I know you guys have it memorized, so we're not going to go into details, but Leviticus, it talks about how if a woman had excessive blood flow, like during her period, or anyone that was bleeding, it was a very bad thing. So they were ceremonially unclean. She was not allowed to go to, there was no temple at the time of Leviticus, but the tabernacle, like she wasn't supposed to go to the place of worship. And she was unworthy to be near God's presence or to be near anyone. Anything she touched was unclean. Any furniture she touched was unclean. If anyone touched something that she had touched, it was making them unclean. So where would you go? You can't really go to the places of worship. You can't really go in public. And in your home, if you had children, you can't really hug them. They can't hug you. You can't really take care of, you can't go into their room at night. You can't, so you just kind of have to be quarantined. You guys are familiar with that word? Not the 10 days or the new improved 5 days, but for 12 years. Extremely isolated. Not only was she considered clean by everyone around, by the religious leaders, but she probably felt it as well. Having to deal with logistics of trying to have to clean the clothes and the linens for 12 years, I don't know if they had Tide and Clorox, but the stains were probably everywhere, always reminding her that she was unclean. Always. How sad. Now, how do you think she saw herself? Unwanted, cursed, of very little value because she couldn't help anyone even when she wanted to. She probably saw herself as filth. As filth. She was desperate though, and she did try to get better. She didn't just accept it. She saw lots of doctors for years. She spent lots of money, but there was no cure, and St. Mark says she actually got worse. She was probably getting broke. She was hopeless. desperate and full of shame. Then she hears about Jesus, who does these miracles. He's doing the impossible. Like in hopeless situations, he's healing lepers. He's giving sight to someone who was born blind. He's casting out demons. Crowds are following him everywhere. And this was the beginning of her faith. She hadn't seen it. You want to know why? Because she's stuck at home. But she heard it. And she believed it. And her faith was born. Her faith was born. She's like, that is my source of healing. My only source. I have no other hope than him. But she has a dilemma. How could she get close to him? She wouldn't want to explain her situation to him in the midst of a crowd. They would have cursed her for even just being there. She's unclean. You're not supposed to be near us. And then she probably thought he wouldn't even touch her because she was unclean. The holy people looked down on her, so maybe Christ would look down on her as well. At different times, we are also this woman. Maybe many of us at times have felt like that woman. We felt shame. We felt maybe isolated, unwanted because of something that we have done. That we have this long-term struggle in our lives. That we have some type of a weakness or a cross that we've held for years. Sometimes we've done something embarrassing or humiliating that we're afraid to acknowledge even to God. Many of us have these deep sins, these dark sins that we do alone, that we isolate, that we don't share them with everyone. They're our hidden sins, that isolating experience. And we actually don't feel like we can go talk to God about it. We're too ashamed. We feel too unclean to go to the presence of God to discuss it with him. There might have been something that you said years ago, or you did something to your spouse or your in-laws or neighbors or co-workers or your children years ago, and you cannot get away from that stain. It haunts you. And it hurts your relationships. And we don't pray sometimes because we don't think we're clean enough to pray. He's not going to listen to me. He's got to be too angry with me. He might hurt me or reject me. I don't belong in the presence of the Holy One. Have you ever felt that? Actually, acknowledging that uncleanness is actually appropriate during Lent. Actually, that's extremely important and appropriate. That's actually what we're supposed to do. You'll understand your desire and your need for the Savior once you acknowledge your uncleanness. So let's go back to the woman. So how does she get close? How do we get close? How do we have this healing touch? In her mind, she's like, I just have to touch him. She has a desperate desire to be made clean. Do we have that desire? Or are we accepting the way we are with all our imperfections, all our impurities? Or do you wish to be made more clean? And you realize that there's only one person that can make you clean. No one else. No one else. Do you have that same desperation? For a new start, you have to be close to him. You can't have so much shame of the stain, but she wants to be clean. She wants to go to the places of worship. She wants to be in the presence of God. She must. She wants to. She knows she desires it, but she shouldn't. I mean, everyone else around her says, you shouldn't. No, you can't. Just don't. But the woman heard that he was coming and knew there would be a crowd, and the odds were against her. Physically, it was almost a miracle with her weakness to fight through a Middle Eastern crowd. You've seen the Middle Eastern crowd. To get to where you want to go in the middle of a Middle Eastern crowd, you require a lot of strength. And no one would have allowed her. And he's not going to maybe touch her. So then she says, I can't touch him, and she can't touch me. He can't touch me. Could I, the unclean person, make the holy one unclean? Is that possible? Maybe she was like, I'm so unclean. Can I make the holy one unclean? That would be horrible. So I don't want to make him unclean, so let me just touch the hem of his garment. That would be enough. I believe in him. Just the smallest thing of Jesus Christ would be more than enough. He is able. And again, who initiated the miracle? She did. Her faith, her effort, her intentional touch. Christ didn't touch her or tell her to be healed. So what exactly did she have? This is what we need to have. Number one, there was an unwavering decision that she had to touch his garment, and nothing would stop her. She's like, I need to touch him. He's coming. I'm not going to be distracted by the crowd. I don't know, you guys were just in a crowd about 10 minutes ago. All those people wanted to be near Jesus. And did you fight, or were you distracted by the crowd? Were you looking at the people, or were you saying, I'm focusing on Jesus. I want to be close to him. You know that he's coming every Sunday. And do you have the intention of touching him? Do you have that desire? Or you just come because I have to go to church because the coffee there, well, no, you guys all have Starbucks, so no, it's not that great. But you guys feel like you have to come to church. How many of you say, I have to touch Jesus? I need to be united with him. I need to have communion with him. Her mind was so simple and so clear. If I touch him, touch his garment, I will be healed. It's very spiritually possible to be in the crowd pressing against Jesus and not be touched, nor for him to be touched by you. If we want our Lord to be touched by our prayer, we have to learn this. Don't just grasp at him so that he'll pay attention to you. You want to know what she did? Don't intentionally bump him with mindlessness. Don't just do scattered prayers, but rather she had this humility and focused faith. I believe you are able. She wasn't trying to stop him. He was going somewhere. She wasn't trying to interrupt him. She wasn't trying to make him her servant. She, as his servant, she saw him as Lord and said, I'm just coming to be near you. That is enough. She didn't think she was worthy of his attention. She just wanted his holiness, his cleansing to flow into her life. She didn't want to bother him, but that touch, that faith, that if I touch him, his holiness will come into my life and I can be made clean. You have that opportunity every time you come to church, but you have to have the intention of getting something. You have to have the humility that she had. I don't deserve it, but I just want to be near him. I desire the union. I desire his holiness. I desire to be made clean. It was... her faith was number two. Christ even said, your faith is what made you well. So she had this desire, I want to connect with Jesus. So don't pray without desiring to connect with him. Don't come to church without desiring to connect. Don't read the Bible without hoping to see him. Pray for that. When you open your Bible, say, Dear Lord Jesus Christ, I wish to draw near to you. I wish to see you. I wish to hear you. I wish to know you. I wish to be united with you. Now this woman had 12 years of physical suffering. Yeah.
Would it be fair to say that she not only wanted to be healed, but she wanted to be clean?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I'm using the word clean and healed interchangeably. For us, it's not necessarily that you need to be healed physically, but every one of us needs to be healed spiritually and cleaned. So yes. So no doctor or power of man could help. So she stopped going to man. And oftentimes this is what we do. We oftentimes look at worldly ways of having our problems fixed. She says, I'm done. There's only one way, so I'm going to go to him. It was a hopeless situation, enduring the label of unclean for all those years. Now I'm going to ask you, what if she was a woman in the crowd, but she never had the issue of blood? You think she would have had that healing touch? She would have just been like, okay, he's coming. Because of her suffering, that might have been the beginning of her faith. For 12 years, she was probably praying. I'm sure she was humble for a long time. She was probably begging for his mercy for a long time. Now, she had to wait. a long time, but I'm sure the suffering is what allowed her to have a different touch than all the thousands that had ever touched him before. We don't always understand why there is a suffering in our lives. We all go through some type of suffering at some point. But sometimes you realize that because of that suffering, now I am trusting him more. I'm drawing close to him more. I need him more. He fills me more. He satisfies me more. He comforts me more. He protects me more. He lifts me up more. Sometimes the suffering is the beginning of the seed of the faith. When everything is fine and you're comfortable, you probably don't. When was the last time you didn't have Starbucks around? You're like, oh my gosh. Well, the people who don't have food for a day or two, they say, God, when will you give me food? I trust. But we probably don't ask God to give us Starbucks. We probably don't ask him for a mix because you're like, I can do this. But if you're suffering, all of a sudden you rely on him more. So she had this intention to draw near to him. She had the faith because her suffering allowed her to be humble and she relied on him and him alone. And the third thing, she had abandoned all her feelings of shame and fear. Many of us don't come close and we never get healed because we're too shameful or too fearful to draw near. She's like, I'm putting that behind me. I know that if I go near him, I have the faith, he will accept me. So then, I'm almost near the end. How does our Lord respond? I mean, I have a question. Did he know that she would be in the crowd? Yeah, he knew she was going to be in the crowd. Did he know that she was suffering? Did he know that she was unclean ceremonially? He did. But it was his desire to make it known that even the unclean could be made clean by him. He could have kept on walking. She could have gotten the miracle. He could have just kept on walking. Why did he stop? I mean, why did he have to make it public that this unclean woman touched him? Was it so that she could be cast away? She could have been stoned. Did he want to embarrass her? He wanted to make her whole and accepted. So that in front of, how would anyone else in the crowd know that she was clean? No one else would know. So he says, you have been made well. But what else does he say? Daughter. Daughter? This unclean person was his daughter? What? Wait a minute. She was his daughter before she was unclean. She was his daughter while she was unclean. And she became more beautiful after she came to him to be made clean. Now, most of you look like you've had children. Yeah, I see the weary faces. But like, you ever let your children go outside or you just walk away and you come back and you're like, how is this mess possible? I didn't know. Like, this is brand new. This is like a new record. They make movies about this kind of mess. And what do? You say, shh. No, what do you say? Tala Habibi, come here. Come here. Okay, some of you do. It's okay. It's okay. Thank God he doesn't. But you say, you're still my daughter and you're still my son. Let me make you clean. I've always seen you as beautiful, and maybe you didn't see yourself as that way, but I don't see you as unclean. And you know what's interesting? She was breaking the law while coming to touch him. She was breaking the law of the Old Testament to do it. He said, you know what? It's okay. Come. You're my daughter. In this instance, the unclean touched the clean and was made clean. He declared her clean. That's what Lent is all about. This is a time where you bring your uncleanness to him, to the cross. And he says, don't worry, daughter or son, I am declaring you clean from now on. Now, I'm not going to read the rest of the passage, but after this miracle, he goes to Jairus' house. But on his way there, the people said, Jairus, she's not sick anymore, she's dead. It's almost like, don't bother him anymore. And what does Jesus Christ do? It's like, she's just sleeping. And what does he go do? He touches her. It's another beautiful touch. He touches her, and his touch raises the dead. So there's a few touches in this story. There is the touch of the crowd that doesn't heal and makes no change in anyone's life. There's no intention, there's no faith, there's no hope. The touch of the crowd, it's almost like our communion touch. There's that touch in this story. We're not doing that anymore. Then there's the touch of this woman who in humility submitted to him. She didn't demand from him. She reached out to him for mercy, for healing, for strength, for forgiveness. He will not embarrass you, regardless of what you've done. He'll never send you away. He will respond graciously, as he always did, to sincere people who had faith. We won't ever make him unclean. Instead, he will make us his beloved sons and daughters. So there's the touch of the crowd, the touch of the woman, and his touch that raises the dead. I pray that you will all draw near to him, that in this holy time, you will feel his touch, and that you will touch him. What I wanted to do as we stand up and pray is I wanted to go to... Claudia, do you know how to go back to the main menu? No. Oh. Okay. We're going to pray this prayer, which is in communion. It's one of the prayers that we can pray every week. Let's stand up and pray, because you'll realize that she is in this prayer. But the spirit of this prayer I find very useful, that you don't have to pray it only in church. You can pray it anytime you want. And I want us to pray it together. So I don't know if you guys can't see the screen. It's on Coptic Reader. If you go to Egbeia, then Prayers, then Communion. It's the one of St. John Chrysostom. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. And with your mind, with your intention, we're going to pray this together. Let's see, this may not be the right one. Hold on. Okay. O Lord my God, I know that I am not worthy nor sufficient that you should enter under my roof into the habitation of my soul. For it is all deserted and in ruins, and there is not a fitting place in me for you to lay your head. But as from the heights of your glory you humbled yourself, so now bear me in my humility. As you deigned to lie in a manger in a cave, so now also come into the manger of my mute soul and corrupt body. As you did not refrain from entering into the house of Simon the leper, or shrink from eating there with sinners, so also vouchsafe to enter the house of my poor soul, all leprous and full of sin. You did not reject the sinful woman who ventured to draw near to touch you, so also have pity on me, a sinner, approaching to touch you. Grant that I may partake of your all-holy body and precious blood for the sanctification, enlightenment, and strengthening of my weak soul and body, for relief from the burden of my many sins, for my preservation against all the snares of the devil, for victory over all my sinful and evil habits, for the mortification of my passions, for obedience in your commandments, for growth in your divine grace, and for the inheritance of your kingdom. For it is not with a careless heart that I approach you, O Christ my God, but I come trusting in your infinite goodness, in fearing lest I may be drawn afar from you and become the prey of the wolf of souls. Therefore I pray to you, O Master, who alone are holy, that you would sanctify my soul and body, my mind and heart and reins, and renew me entirely. Implant in my members the fear of you, be my helper and guide, directing my life in the path of peace, and make me worthy to stand at your right hand with your saints, through the prayers and intercessions of your pure mother, of the heavenly powers, and of all the saints who from all ages have been well-pleasing unto you. Amen. I feel like this prayer could be your prayer. This is the same spirit she had. You can pray it for... We're done. Glory be to God forever. Amen. By the way, if you want to know her name is Saint Veronica. And After she had this miracle, she had two statues made, one of Christ reaching out as if healing and one of her bowing. They found these statues for centuries, and actually many miracles were done through those statues. As she was healed, she then became a healer. Veronica means true icon. Some of the traditions say when Christ was holding the cross and on the road, she was the one that had the cloth that touched his face that had the image on it, like the shroud. Not the shroud, but it was like one of those. So Veronica comes from vero iconum, which is true image. And that tradition, I'm not 100% sure, but the statues is well known. That's St. Veronica. Have a blessed day.